Well, good evening, everyone. This is the Campus Nation Sports Planet. We are live from Fiesta Veracruz Mexican Restaurant at 37 West Locust Street in Wilmington, Ohio. Their phone number, 937-382-1734. We invite you to come down and sit in on our live show. Or, of course, if you're listening on any of the one or many places that you can listen to us, WALH 106.7 FM right here in Wilmington, Ohio. And also WZAA 106.9 if you're in the Fayette County, Greene County area. And, of course, on talktv.us. And here is Bill Raybeck, the host of our show.
Thank you, Rick. Well, everyone, it's that time of the year when a young man's fancy turns to the NFL draft. So we will be racking and stacking and packing the GMs for our mock draft, which will be Sunday, April 23rd, 1 to 4, which, as Rick had said, that will be on WALH 106.7 here in Wilmington, WZAA 106.9 in Jeffersonville, and then, of course, on talktv.us. So that'll be the third year that we've done the draft. We've got a lot more GMs are actually picking from the cities that these teams reside in. And I think that's going to make it more interesting, Rick, that we've got people that have a vested interest in those teams.
Oh, absolutely. Now, who are we bringing in from, is it San Diego or L.A.?
Well, hopefully Dave Schwab, who's a writer out there for the community newspapers, who we talked to a few weeks ago about the Chargers relocating. We hope to have Dave on talking about the Chargers, the L.A. Chargers, and the L.A. Rams.
So, and of course, we've got now the approval and the blessing from the NFL of moving the Oakland Raiders to
Vegas.
Las Vegas. I wonder how that's going to work out.
Well, we'll see. I mean,
$2 billion stadium they're building for them.
Yeah, and there's still a there's still some financial question with this whole thing. I'm curious to see how it's all going to work out, but Mark Davis has taken the money and ran with it. And,
as anybody would, I guess.
And we'll see how it works. But, of course, the Raiders moving again. The poor city of Oakland, although, you know, in some ways, Oakland shares responsibility for losing the Raiders. But at the same time, the people of Oakland don't deserve that. They've supported the Raiders since 1960. Arguably, I was watching a special on ESPN the other night, and they were talking about the NFL brands. I mean, the names that are national brands. And the Oakland Raiders are a national brand. I mean, they were the first one to play, the second team to play in a Super Bowl from the AFL at that time. They have won 3 Super Bowls. They've had great success. They have a legacy of great players that have went through Oakland, although not so much recently. But the thing is, the Raiders are one of those national brands. They went from Oakland to L.A. That didn't work out. And then back to Oakland.
Right.
And I would not be surprised if we saw them go to Vegas.
And back to Oakland.
And Oakland somehow along the way builds a new stadium, and then they're going to jump back. You know, they call Oakland a small market, yet they're really in the San Francisco, San Jose Bay area.
Right, so there's plenty of people out there and plenty of television out there.
It's by no means a small market.
No. So,
and I think for many years, the San Francisco people, before the 80s rolled along, were probably Oakland Raiders fans.
Well, yeah, because Oakland had a much more competitive team than San Francisco.
Right.
So until San Francisco beat the Bengals a few times in the Super Bowl, they really hadn't done much as far as teams.
Right. They were not the marketable name in the Bay Area. So we'll see what happens with that. We do have a gentleman we hope to have on. He ironically lives in San Diego. He is he works for the San Diego State newspaper, and he is a vested Raiders fan, although he is from the Oakland area. So we may have him come on. He's shown some interest. We have a gentleman from Dallas that's going to pick for the Cowboys this year, who is related to Scott Wilcox, who later in the show will be picking for the Kansas City Chiefs. So, you know, we're getting that. And if anybody's watching in the city and you're a fan of a particular franchise, we invite you to contact
us. Oh, absolutely. They can participate.
Yeah, we would like to get a GM from every city in the NFL,
right,
opposed to us having 17 guys in Ohio picking for these teams,
right,
which we've done for, you know, several years now.
So we have local sports?
We do have local sports. Let's jump into that.
All right.
In boys baseball action yesterday, the Wilmington Hurricanes battered McLean 13-1. Wilmington is 1-0 in the SOL and now 1-2 overall. Clinton Massey blasted Washington High School 8-0. The Falcons pitchers Noah Greathouse and Weston Trampler combined for a 5-hit performance. Trampler helped his own cause by getting 3 hits and driving in 4 runs. Blanchester slipped by CNE 2-1. Blake Baker picked up the victory for Bland in relief. The Wildcats' Gavin Creighton had 2 home runs and 3 RBIs to lead the offensive attack. Blanchester is 1-0 in SBC play and 1-2 overall. In Hillsboro yesterday, the East Clinton Astros were overwhelmed by the Indians 14-1. Zach Mitchell, Matt Hall, and Austin Arellano each had a hit for the Astros. East Clinton is 0-1 in the SOL, 2-1 overall. In girls softball yesterday, East Clinton drilled Hillsboro 14-1, returning the favor that the boys team delivered upon the East Clinton baseball team. Sierra Christian, who's been dynamite this year, worked all 5 innings to pick up her 2nd win of the year, allowing only 1 hit. Michaela Smith had 4 of the Astros' 10 stolen bases in the game. Taylor Beckman led the Astro attack with 2 hits. The Astros are now 1-0 in the SCOL and 3-0 overall. Clinton Massey dismantled Washington 17-4. Taylor Floria pitched all 6 innings for Massey, allowing 6 hits and picking up 8 strikeouts. The Falcons' Lindsey Amberger led the offensive attack with a home run and 4 RBIs. Victoria Sievert and Floria each contributed 4 hits apiece. Massey is 1-0 on the season. Wilmington smacked McLean 15-2 yesterday. The Hurricanes were a machine with a pitching performance of 5 innings of, you know, 2-run baseball, struck out 5, and were pretty good at the plate, too. So those are all the details we have on it, but Wilmington is, and we don't have the record on that, unfortunately, either. In boys tennis, Hillsboro beat East Clinton 5-0. Washington shut out Massey 5-0. Western Brown beat Blanchester 4-1. In men's lacrosse, Wabash College beat Wilmington College 10-9. Jordan Lang had 4 goals, and Reed Delaney had 3 goals for the Quakers. Wilmington College stands at 2-6 on the season. In women's softball, Hanover dumped the Wilmington College girls in a doubleheader, 5-1 and 3-1. Rick, we have some interesting news for the Wilmington College girls basketball team.
Costa Rica?
They are traveling to Costa Rica for a series of 3 friendship games, international games. So I don't know if they're all going to be against Costa Rican teams, or maybe some Central American countries will be there too. But anyhow, they're going down there. What a great opportunity for the Wilmington College girls.
Yeah, and you were saying that Mike Snar there at Wilmington College is the guy that is heading this all up.
Yeah, Mike Snar is identified as the contact point if you'd like to make contributions to help the girls out with this, or just find out more about the trip. I don't know if they're taking maybe other people with them. I have that opportunity to travel with the girls. If you'd like to reach Mike, you can call him at 937-481-2436, or you can reach him via email at michael_snar@wilmington.edu. So that is the local buzz. Of course, coming up here, Rick, on April 15th, which is a Saturday, we will be doing our 3rd annual Ohio State spring game tailgate party.
Yeah, we had a lot of fun last year.
We did. Hope that everybody can make it out, and we'll have more details as we get closer to that date about what parking lot we're going to set up in and get up there. And, you know, stop by, give us an idea how you think the Buckeyes are going to do this year.
Yeah, we'll put you on camera.
Get you on camera. You get to express your opinions to everybody. And we had a good time. You know, if the one thing about the spring game, and Rick and I were just talking about that, is, you know, there's some people that kind of get snarky about all these Ohioans that go to the spring game because they say, well, there's nothing better to do, you know. And, you know, my response is, if you're a fan of the team, it doesn't matter whether you're it's in the fall or in the spring.
Well, you could put over 100,000 people in the Ohio State Stadium for a spring game that doesn't count other than the fact that you've got half the team playing the other half of the team. That's pretty impressive. It's the biggest number as far as attendance of any spring game of any Big Ten school. So what does that say?
Absolutely. And it was, I guess, Alabama at one point had 92,000. And last year, the Buckeyes the Buckeyes had beat that the year before with 99,000, and then this past year they had 100,000. I guess those numbers will, with the big power schools like Ohio State, Alabama, I would imagine we'll continue to see those numbers escalate because it becomes a competition between those two schools to see who can get more to the spring game. But, you know, it's $5 to get in, Rick. And to go see a regular season game, first of all, you have to get the tickets, which is sometimes difficult. Secondly,
2 pints of blood and some 70
other
bucks.
And some other body parts that you might want. And, yeah, you know, I think it's almost up to $80 a game now. That's if you can get them at face value, and that's not even guaranteed you can do that. But you can go to the spring game. You can take your wife. You can take, you know, how many ever kids you have, and you can get there and get in for $30. I mean, if you got four kids and two parents, the food is reduced because they're trying to get rid of a lot of the 2016 inventory. And, you know,
so you're saying that's a 2016 hot dog?
Well, no, I'm not saying that, but what I'm saying is they have a lot of promotions.
Stale popcorn.
Yeah. Yeah, they keep it in bags. They put it in the freezer so you can come out there and munch on it. They have a lot of the cups that say 2016. They have the 2016 schedule. So if you get a soda, you get a 2016 Ohio State.
It's a collector's item now.
And it's in, you know, anything that's got Ohio State on it. You know, one of the local stores here that's unfortunately going out of business has some jerseys over there, and everything else is discounted. But when you get into the NCAA stuff and the NFL stuff, the discounts only bring it down to a less shocking price than the original price.
So you only have to take out a mortgage once.
That's right. So, you know, giving an example, the vertically striped gray shirts that Ohio State wore as a throwback during the last season, JT Barrett's jersey is $150.
Oh, it's a
bargain.
And,
of course, you can see mine. Now, this is one that we got at a local retailer, and that one ran me about $19. So, you know, it just depends on what you want to drop on one of those jerseys. It's nice to be a fan, but you don't want to break the bank on it.
So, are we ready for our first GM?
Yes, and we're going to be talking with Trey Sackstetter. Trey is a fan of the Tennessee Titans.
He's actually a local product, at least as far as where he's talking to us from, right?
Yes, he is. He lives here in Wilmington. He's from Indiana originally. Trey, this is Bill Rayback with WALH, WZAA, and TalkTV.us. How are you today?
I'm all right.
Trey, I appreciate you taking the mantelpiece there to become the Titans GM here in our mock draft. And I wanted to talk to you tonight about where the Titans are, where they're going, and, you know, some projections for the upcoming draft. Let's first start with free agency, maybe key losses due to injury, retirements. What can you tell us about the Titans at this point?
It's definitely pretty bad time. It's come a long way. I mean, last year in the free agency, we added Michael Murray. That was definitely a huge addition for us. As long as Rashard Matthews as well, he performed well for us. So, issue with the free agency, we really looked to add defense. That was the main focal point. We had a few free agents we were looking to acquire. Weren't able to get everybody we wanted.
Right.
On the losses aspect, we didn't lose too much, honestly. Things that were maybe going forward in the direction of the Titans, so they wasn't really at the end of the world for it.
Sure.
So I feel on an addition, though, we definitely added a lot of strong defensive players. You know, Dick LeBeau, obviously, is a great defensive coordinator and did well for the Steelers for years. So,
Trey, one thing that I've heard repeatedly, I think you said this the other day, the Titans are really building themselves into a team like the Steelers in some sense. Of course, Mike Mularkey is there, and it seems that they just have that grit and toughness. They like to run the ball, and of course, they were able to add a key component a couple of years ago with Marcus Mariota. How is Marcus's health? He suffered a broken fibula, correct, last year?
Yeah.
What's the prognosis? Is it going to be full recovery? How did the Titans see that going forward?
Well, he's recovering well. He actually is ahead of schedule from everything that we've gathered. He is progressing along. He should be just fine for summer camp. Maybe not full work at the beginning, but definitely is going to be able to participate, get in sync with the offense. Obviously, at the end of the year when he was injured, the offensive, for the most part, was rolling. I mean, Mariota started out a little slow, but then he definitely turned in to a premier young quarterback for the league.
Sure.
There's a lot of promise with him and a lot of promise going forward with Titans.
What now? You talked a little bit about the free agency, and of course they did get DeMarco Murray, which they made a solid commitment towards running the football, which obviously has to take pressure off of Mariota, play action. If you've got that threat of the run, it just opens things up so much more. But you talked a little bit about defense. Who are some of the key additions that they looked at, and who might be out there that's still floating around that the Titans might bring in? Of course, there'll be a second round of free agency shortly after the draft when players get cut in that. Is there anybody that you would like to see that you think would just be a solid addition to the Titans?
Obviously, Dont'a Hightower is somebody we were really hoping we were going to be able to bring in. He's got Nashville roots. Unfortunately, he decided to go with the Patriots, so that really kind of hurt us, that linebacker position.
Right.
We're still looking, kind of milling around and seeing what's out there. Obviously, with the additions of Jonathan Slifer and Logan Ryan were huge for us, the defensive backfield.
Okay.
And we also had, Sylvester Williams with the nose tackle, proven defense out there in Denver, big boy, come in and stop the run.
Sure. So definitely got a two gap player there, which helps.
Yeah, he's a big guy. Denver's always been statistically really good against the run, and he was the focal point of that. And there's definitely a lot of promise with him. So it's definitely something we're looking forward to. Coach LeBeau, I know, is looking forward to it as well.
When
free agency wise, it's just going to kind of depend, I think, on the draft too. Obviously, we're going to have to see what spots we fill with the draft, and then what we're going to need. And obviously, it will depend on who is being released from teams and didn't work out. We'll kind of go.
Right. What is the the feeling there? I mean, in your division, it looks like. Just a couple of years ago, people were saying that the AFC South was the worst division in football. And I would argue that it's quickly developing maybe into one of the better young divisions in football with the Titans. I think with Tom Coughlin coming in, with Jacksonville, I think they're going to be improved. Of course, Indianapolis, I think Indianapolis all of a sudden got old. But you're going to see them start to try to get younger. So I think that's, and of course, I'm not even mentioning the Texans who won the division, but it is a pretty good division, and I think the Titans are going to be right in it this year.
Yeah, we definitely, 9-7 last year. Major improvement from the previous year where we only were able to win a few games. obviously, the Colts have been the leader for years. And the AFC South, you know, some people forget about this. But about 6-7 years ago, the AFC South was one of the best divisions in football.
Right.
And they did drop off. But I do agree with, you know, Coughlin coming in there to Jacksonville with Blake Bortles and them. I really see them, you know, gaining, and especially their offseason agents acquisitions were huge.
Right.
Obviously, they had a really nice draft. So I see the AFC South improving. Obviously, we'll see what happens with the quarterback decision in the Texans with Romo. But we feel as the Titans that we have, you know, we're focusing on the run, focusing on defense, which is what wins you games and allows you to control the game.
Right.
And with protects Mariota, hopefully we don't suffer another injury. And so we really feel that that's set to get us to the, over the hump, win the division, and to control the division for the next several years.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a fun division. So we go into the draft. The Titans hold 2 picks, correct?
That is correct.
And so how do you see this unfolding? I know we talked a little bit about your wish list a couple days ago. Where do you see them going? Now, are they, what, at 5 and 16 are their picks?
We have 5 and 18.
So what? How do you see that playing out? Who would be at number 5? Who are the two guys that if you got a realistic shot at them, you'd like to take with that pick?
We feel that we need to probably add another. We have two main positions that we feel we need to add. We need to add to our defensive backfield, and we need to go after a number one wideout.
Okay.
Most likely, with the talent available, this is a really deep receiver class.
Right.
We're probably going to lean towards more of going a defensive backfield. People that we're interested are Malik Hooker, safety out of Ohio State.
Right.
Marshawn Lattimore, cornerback out of Ohio State. And then also the talent, Jamal Adams, safety out of LSU. Those are the three main defensive backs that we feel would be a great addition to this Dick LeBeau defense that we run.
Okay. How do you and you talked about wide receiver. Where would you like to see them go with their other, as far as what they might do with that?
Well, we have Tajay Sharp, who is a young, quick receiver. We also have Rishard Matthews.
Right.
We've obviously parted away with Kendall Wright, who was a number one draft pick out of Baylor a couple years ago.
Sure.
So we really are feeling that we need to go get a big, strong, physical receiver.
Right.
And Corey Davis out of Western Michigan has had a tremendous college career. And he's physical, he's strong. He reminds us a lot of Terrell Owens type of build and body.
Right.
Sure-handed catching. He's definitely probably the number one receiver we're looking to get.
Okay.
There's a lot of talent with Mike Williams out of Clemson. But we like the size of Corey Davis.
Okay, you like Corey Davis. Let me ask you this, and I've just pulled up several mock drafts. I'm going to throw this at you. With number 5, Corey Davis was the first guy, picked him. Marshawn Lattimore, another player that you talked about, the corner out of Ohio State. Hassan Riddick, the defensive end out of Temple, who's been compared to the Raiders. The guy that got out of Eastern Michigan, and his name is escaping me for a second, but I'll be back with that one. Hassan Riddick, and then Malik Hooker, the safety out of Ohio State. So you were pretty much right on there with those early picks.
Yeah, we definitely feel they're can't miss out. Especially the two defensive backs from Ohio State, very physical. Obviously, Ohio State football is known for defense, and
right.
Over the last several years, they have produced outstanding defensive backs, and they are producing in the NFL.
Yeah, and then would your 18th pick, it has one gentleman picked O.J. Howard, tight end from Alabama. This one I know you'll like. John Ross, the wide receiver out of Washington. Forrest Lamp, offensive guard from Western Kentucky. And then, again, Corey Davis. So two out of the eight picks on this mock draft have Corey Davis. So that looks like there's a strong possibility that Corey Davis might be wearing the blue of the Tennessee Titans.
We're going to hope that we can get something like that.
Okay. Well, Trey, appreciate you being on WALH, WZAA, and TalkTV.us. We look forward to you joining us on the 23rd for the NFL mock draft, and we will talk to you here in the near future.
All right. Thank you.
And that is Trey Sackstetter, the general manager for the Tennessee Titans.
We'd like to remind everybody that we are coming live from Fiesta Veracruz Mexican Restaurant, 37 West Locust Street, right here in Wilmington, Ohio, 937-382-1734. And, of course, we are streaming live, both Rick Phillips and Bill Raybeck. And we're streaming live on WALH 106.7 FM right here in Wilmington, Ohio, WZAA 106.9 in Fayette County, Jeffersonville, Ohio, and, of course, on TalkTV.us.
And hopefully in the near future, as we will be moving into some new digs here in the near future, we would like to get some open lines where you, the listeners, can participate.
That's right. With the advent of our new studios, and you can see those on the WZAALPFM.com website, some nice digs, and we are in Jeffersonville, the Jeffersonville Northernmost Mall is where we'll be located, but we will have both our Campus Nation and our Talk TV audio and video facilities, as well as WZAA 106.9 FM right there in Jeffersonville, Ohio, located there in the studios.
And, of course, you can always drop in here at Fiesta Veracruz if you'd like to grab a mic and give us your opinion on some of this stuff. There's open seats every time we're here. We never know who's going to come in here from time to time. And feel free to do that. We would love to see some people come in and give us your opinion. Of course, our local coverage will be expanding here in the near future, as we will be carrying Miami Trace Sports, and we'll be carrying
Washington
High School.
That's right.
And so that's going to be, of course, if you can't tell, we have a birthday celebration going on here at Fiesta Veracruz in the background.
It's not your birthday, and it's not my birthday. Now, maybe it's Lee Hindi in our studio's birthday. Happy birthday,
the
Lee.
The legend back in the studio there at WALH, Lee Hindi. And maybe it is Lee's birthday. I think he has like two of those a year.
At least.
he makes out on that deal, I think.
That's right.
So
are we ready for Mike Fritz?
Yes, and we are going to be having Michael Fritz come on. Now, Mike has been with us for 3 years in this draft format. He has been the general manager, sadly, for the Cleveland Browns. And hopefully Mike will have better luck. He was right a couple years ago. He wanted Johnny Manziel, and we got Johnny Manziel.
Yeah, look at that turned out.
To my dismay, he was not the guy that I wanted. But, taking a look at it, I think that it could have been worse. I don't know if it could have been worse. But, Derek.
Hi, you've reached Michael Fritz.
So I guess he's not available.
Right now.
Okay, so
we'll
try to get him.
We will hopefully get a hold of Mike in a second, as I will try to contact him. But, one of the things, I'm going to drop back to the spring game. Ohio State has several decisions to make here as in some positions. They have one of the most talented freshman classes coming in, and about 10 to 12 of those kids are early enrollees, which meant that they finished high school a semester early so that they could enroll at Ohio State and be involved in spring football practice. And one of those gentlemen is Baron Browning out of Texas. And Ohio State was just raving about this kid. And unfortunately, what happened is he tore up his shoulder a little bit. Now, Urban says that he will be back with us before football starts in the the fall. So we're hoping that Baron Browning's going to be back. D.K. Dobbins, another running back who's out of Texas, and Rick, he's favorably been compared to Zeke.
Really?
Yes. And he has actually moved to the second position on the Buckeyes depth chart. So, you know, we're looking forward during the spring game to see how Dobbins plays. Mike Weber's coming back as the number one guy. But it's, you know, competition will make him better. And so it'll be good to see how Dobbins does there. Of course, they're rebuilding the secondary, and as Urban was quoted the other day, was talking about Ohio State used to be offensive line U. In the last 10 years, they've become defensive back U as they keep on putting two or three DBs into the NFL every year, which is a nice situation to have, but at the same time, it creates a problem because you're constantly replacing those guys. And they're not staying 4 years. They're staying 3 years, and they're leaving, in some cases, two if they're redshirt. So, you know, the Buckeyes need to move forward with what they're going to do with that. I've heard that Keith Sheffield, keep that name in mind, was a recruit at Alabama, and I think he attended Blinn Junior College. And he went to that junior college. He finished there, and now he will be with the Buckeyes. He was the first. They have a tradition when freshmen come in, they put a black stripe on their helmet. And I had just read that Keith Sheffield was the first of the freshmen to have his black stripe removed from his helmet.
So I guess that's Mike.
Okay, and do we have Mike?
Hello,
Mike Fritz. How you doing?
Sorry,
there for it. That's all right. You're a Cleveland GM, so you're probably asleep at the wheel.
That's
then.
Right.
that's right. Yeah. That's when I take the pick.
Uh-huh. Yeah, you know, I think that happened, Mike, when the Johnny Manziel thing came down.
Oh, please don't remind me.
Well, that was a great pick. Almost as good as RG3, right?
Well, at least we didn't go into the RG3 thing with too much of a commitment on that one.
Yeah, not a lot of hope.
Yeah, not a first-round draft choice, at least. Hey, Mike,
you know,
looking at the Browns, let's talk about free agency, some of the moves they've made, losses, and what they did to replace them. I was impressed. I thought the Browns did a pretty nice job in free agency.
Yeah, I did too, especially you know, I'm a big fan of improving through the lines, and I think that picking up Zeitler from Cincinnati was a good pickup, and, you know, just improving a little bit through the TJ Lane was a good pickup there at center, and just the small guys that we could get there for our offensive line.
Yeah. Well, you know, Treader has been a pretty decent offensive lineman for the Packers, and for the Browns to be able to pick him up, I think that's going to be huge. And of course, Sean Coleman, who's returning, I believe he's the lineman out of Alabama who had the had cancer, correct?
Yes, yeah, that's him.
And he's just a big kid. The hope is that somebody on the Browns roster is going to emerge and take that position. And I think Sean Coleman could be that kid.
Yeah, I think he definitely could be the one who could do that.
Any other things that they did in free agency? How did you feel about the re-signing of Jamie Collins?
Hey, you know, we don't have any good players. The ones we do, we better make sure we do.
Yeah, I think that's a key component, that outside linebacker position. You know, they compare him to Von Miller, and even if he's in the same conversation with Von Miller, that makes him one of the top outside linebackers in the league.
Heck yeah, definitely. Von Miller is a great player. And the little bit we've seen from Jamie Collins, that's proven he's an athletic linebacker. Doesn't mind to get his nose a little bit dirty.
You know, I was hoping in free agency the Browns might have made a strong move to try to get Dante Hightower, another New England linebacker, to fill that middle position, and then we came up a little bit short on that.
Yeah.
Anything defensively, I mean, losses, additions we've made that you think are going to have a profound effect beyond Jamie Collins?
I'm really hoping we're going to improve that through the draft, get some young players. We didn't really focus on that through free agency, and there wasn't really anybody of note that we didn't re-sign for us. So.
Right. So we look at the holes that we still have. Is there somebody sitting out there in free agency that, you know, you would say, hey, let's go out and get that guy? Because there's going to be a second round of free agency. Everybody seems to, you know, they get this perspective of, we didn't get who we wanted. But after the NFL draft, there will be another round of cuts, which will open up some free agents, which, you know, maybe they're going to fill a few other spots. Anyone out there? I mean, of course, they lost Terrell Pryor to Washington. And what do you think about Josh Gordon? I mean, where do you sit with that as far as Gordon? Will the Browns give him another shot? Are they going to release him? Apparently, he's been clean for a while. Does that give us hope that he may be able to come back?
Well, I mean, you know, with Josh Gordon, I understand the idea of wanting to get him to start over fresh, but heck, he's such a good talent, you might as well just keep him. Because you know our luck, we'll cut him, he'll go to some established organization and be the best wide receiver in the league, and we're going to be the one paying for it in years to come. So, I mean, it doesn't hurt to keep him and just see if he can give us anything at all.
Yeah, I guess anything is better than nothing. I mean, if he could reproduce 1 or 2 years like he had the one full year he played, I'd take that.
Heck, if he can just be on the field and just take off pressure from the other wide receivers, then he does it. It's well worth it to me.
So we move into the draft. The Browns are sitting at 1-12. I think it's pretty universal. You never know with Cleveland.
But yeah, you never know.
Myles Garrett seems to be the no-brainer pick for the Browns. You think that's where the Browns will go with the number one pick?
Yeah, I mean, I feel that's how we're about to go. He's just such an athletic freak, and just, you know, he has the possibility to be one of those prospects, you know, that like a once-in-a-generation type defensive end. So I think at worst with him, he'd be a solid starter. So, I mean, we might as well take him, and luckily we have two picks. If we somehow screw that up, another pick that we make up for.
As long as we go 50-50, right?
Exactly. Yeah, we'll take good odds.
So we go to the 12th pick, and that's the interesting pick, I think. I heard a rumor the other day that the Browns have talked to the Titans about switching the Titans 5 pick, or the Browns get the 5 pick for their 12, and they've got a package of some other draft choices they've accumulated. The question is, where do they go with that number 5 if they move up, and is it going to be a quarterback?
Well, if they did want to do that, I could definitely see them going for a quarterback. And, you know, talking with you aside in conversation aside from this show, I think we're both kind of on the Mitch Trubisky kind of there. We think he's probably one of the best quarterbacks in this draft if we're going to go that route. But I'll tell you a little bit of a sleeper pick for me, but I don't know how you feel about this, but number 5 pick. Our safeties on defense are sometimes so bad that I would not just go for someone that's athletic. And I know you're quite a fan of the type of athlete he is, the different defense and head rooting for defense.
Yeah, I wouldn't be upset if Malik Hooker's there at 5, and that's why the Browns move up to get him. I think that would be a strong pick. Trubisky, I've heard a lot about two kids. Trubisky, obviously the Browns, I guess, were out 30 times during the season to see him. That leads me to believe that Cleveland has a pretty strong interest in him. And I think the thing that you have to look at with Trubisky, maybe over Deshaun Watson or although Deshaun Kizer is from Toledo also, is Trubisky wants to play in Cleveland.
That's not an easy thing to find.
No, and I think if you're one of the top prospects as a quarterback and you want to come play in Cleveland, that's got to make the Browns feel a bit better that he's not going to be malcontent where, you know, you bring in a high name or a high-ranking shining star like Deshaun Watson, and he goes, yeah, I'm not really excited. And he said that more or less, that he didn't have an interest in coming to the Browns. So Trubisky could be there. I've also seen a lot of drafts that have them taking O.J. Howard with that 12th pick. And
yeah, that one would be a bad idea because, I mean, he's such a freak athlete and difference maker at tight end. That could definitely help us out in the offense.
And we could run a little two tight end set with Barnage and O.J. Howard, and that could be pretty nice.
Yeah, I mean, basically at this point, we need playmakers on offense and defense, whoever they think is the best pass if we got there.
Yeah, I like that, to go with the best athlete. Well, Mike, we're running short here, but I appreciate you coming on. Of course, the draft is going to be on April 23rd from 1 to 4, and we will have you on. Of course, you're going to be on the hot seat right away as you have the first pick there. Should be pretty easy, we think. So
We think. You never know. I'm in a wild card.
Yeah, Mike might trade him away there. But, Mike, we'll look forward to talking to you there on the 23rd, and thanks for joining us on WALH, WZAA, and TalkTV.us.
All right, see you.
And that was Mike Fritz, the GM for the Cleveland Browns, giving us his perspective. And, Rick, it's going to do a little station ID for us.
Oh, we don't have to do a station ID. We'll just go to Tim for our next call-in guest.
And, of course, one of our regular guests, Tim Fillinger, will be joining us. Tim has, for the last few years, picked for the Packers. And he picked for the Cowboys last year. And we believe we have a gentleman that's going to pick for the Cowboys this year. So Tim is, at this point, still picking for the Packers. Of course, at the end of the season, Aaron Rodgers was as hot as a firecracker.
He was, wasn't he?
Yeah. And I think everybody was caught by surprise that Atlanta eliminated the Packers so easily in that playoff game. I think there's some problems in Green Bay. Something doesn't seem to add up there. A good part of the season, they just looked like they weren't very interested in playing football. And there's scuttle that Aaron Rodgers isn't the easiest guy to get along with, and he's not a real great clubhouse guy. The difference between him and Jay Cutler is he wins. Jay Cutler's not Jay Cutler's not a great clubhouse guy, but he doesn't win. So therefore, I mean, it's
why do you put up with him, right?
Yeah, you put up with him. Of course, he's floating around out there. His name has surfaced with half a dozen NFL teams as being, at his age, he's stopgap at best. He's going to come in. He's going to play a few years. I don't know that he's better than Josh McCown, though, anymore. And what kind of damage does he do to your team?
That's the key. The key is some of these players are toxic in the clubhouse, and they're going to cause more problems than they're going to solve problems.
I mean, Cutler got shipped out of Denver because, didn't like him there. Chicago, he wasn't well-received. I just don't know. I just don't know if he's one of those guys.
Sounds like a New York kind of guy, though.
Well, I would love to see him go to the Jets. And, and I have nothing against the Jets. I kind of the two New York teams, I kind of have a little bit of an affection for the Jets because of the fact that they were the first American Football League team to break through. And really, the Jets winning the Super Bowl was probably one of the key factors in triggering a merger. And, of course, Joe Willie Namath, who, retrospectively, we look back at the time, Joe Namath was considered this great talent. He beat the Baltimore Colts, who were 13-14-1 that year. Yet, numbers-wise, I don't know that we could look at him and say that it was a great, he is a great quarterback. He's a good quarterback. And I think that, but at the time, it looked like he was on the verge of becoming this Joe Montana.
Yeah. Before we go with Tim, we're gonna talk to JJ. So got him queued up here. We'll give him a call and see what and his take. What team is he representing?
JJ is a Jacksonville Jaguars fan. He was at the time.
So we call him JJ?
Yes, we call him JJ. I call him JJ still. And he. JJ, this is Bill Rayback on WALH, WZAA, and TalkTV.us, sometimes known as Dad to you. And how are you doing tonight?
I'm doing well. How are you doing?
Good. Well, we've had the Titans GM on. We've had the Browns GM on. We're going to put you on the hot seat now. We're going to talk to you a little bit about your favorite team, the Jacksonville Jaguars. You know, looking at the offseason, Tom Coughlin has come in. I think he's lent some stability. He, of course, was a very successful coach with the Jaguars at one point. What did you feel about the offseason? What did you see some good additions for the Jaguars? And where do you think they're going to go? Do you think there's going to be more free agents signed? Or do you think now they're just going to sit back and go to the draft?
Yeah, I think your key acquisitions here at this offseason were Calais Campbell and A.J. Boye. And Brandon Albert in the trade they had before free agency started. But having Calais Campbell next to Malik Jackson this year should be pretty terrifying defensive line.
Yep. When I was talking to the Titans GM, one thing that I had talked to him about is your division has went from, you know, a few years ago being viewed as being awful to where you've got the Texans are really probably a Tony Romo away from being a Super Bowl contender. You've got the Colts who got just really old really fast, but could, you know, they've got Andrew Luck could come back very quickly. The Titans would Mariota have been good? And then, of course, the Jaguars, I think the key thing for you guys is, does Blake Bortles have a year like he did 2 years ago and get, you know, get off the slide?
Yeah, I think the problem he had this year was weak offensive line, and I think that really hurt Bortles this year. And I think that they'll address that in the draft. And you were saying any other key free agents they could take, and I was looking, and I think just as like a veteran presence they could get Austin Pastor, who's the right tackle from the Cleveland Browns. He wasn't a great tackle, but he could at least put a little bit of stability there.
Right, and you know, and I think that is, you get that offensive line, Bortles does have some good wide receivers.
Yeah, I agree.
And
really what they need to look at right now is tight end as another receiver.
Now, do you think O.J. Howard is in play at number four? Do you think that's too high for them to look at tight end? Or it's supposed to be a deep draft for tight end, so do you think they might wait and go somewhere else looking for a tight end?
Well, what I would like to see the Jaguars do is trade down. Honestly, everyone has been picking Leonard Fournette at four right now in their mock draft.
Right.
And I don't think Chris Ivory is a terrible running back. And I think you saw that offensive line problems is the reason why in the running game, same problem with Bortles not having any protection.
Sure.
So I'd like to see him trade down. And if they could trade down still in the top 10, then yeah, if they go to Howard, that'd be the top guy they would take.
Sure. You know, I'm looking at who's right behind him. There has been rumors that the Titans have been shopping that fifth pick, but I've heard they wanted to trade down, so I don't know that they would look up. Unless there's just somebody sitting there, their GM said that Corey Davis is a guy that they really like. And then he also said that John Ross out of Washington are two guys that they covet. So maybe the Panthers at eight could be a possibility. The Bengals are sitting there at nine. It's really hard to say when you start trying to predict where they're going to go in terms of trades. But I guess they have several options. It just depends on who is behind them that wants to move up and get a particular player.
Yeah, and I guess Tom Coughlin likes to rotate defensive line players.
Right.
Like a couple years ago, we had that Super Bowl team. We had OCU and Manera, Justin Tuck, and like a couple other defensive linemen. It was basically four defensive ends playing the all four.
Right.
So I've seen them trying, maybe looking at Thomas of Stanford.
That'd be
but
solid.
I don't know at number four if you want a rotational guy. I don't know if that's a number four pick though.
What about, you know, I'm looking at offensive tackles. You have Ryan Ramczyk from Wisconsin, who's generally regarded as the best offensive tackle. Some people think long-term that Garrett Bowles, the offensive tackle out of Utah, could be the best pick. Do you see him? I mean, they took Tony Boselli years ago, number one. Could you see them going that high with someone like Ramczyk or Bowles?
I don't see any offensive tackle going in the top 10, to be honest.
Okay.
Which is why I have no problem with trading back to like 12 or 15 or stuff like that and taking someone like Bowles or Robinson.
And then what do you think about Jonathan Allen? I've seen some drafts that have them looking. You talked about the defensive line rotation. Do you think Jonathan Allen might be a guy that they would look at?
Yeah, they could do that. I don't really understand taking a defensive lineman that high. With that being one of their stronger suits right now, I just don't see a rotational defensive lineman, if that's how you're going to use them, being that high of a value to you.
In the secondary, of course, there's a couple Ohio State players sitting there. Marshawn Lattimore, of course, tested really well at the combine. And then, of course, at safety, you've got Malik Hooker from Ohio State, Jabril Pepper. I've seen Jabril Pepper's name come up with the Jaguars a couple times. Could you see him going that high with one of those picks?
Well, they just signed Barry Church from the Cowboys as a strong safety. But he's 29, and he really has only had one good year, which was last year. So I could see him taking someone as like a security blanket like that. And I think the value of maybe taking like Jamal Adams out of LSU or Malik Hooker, I think the value's there.
Right. Well, Hooker with his ball skills, I think, you know, and of course, a couple of both our GMs have compared him to Ed Reed, is that not only is he a great cover guy, but he's actually an offensive threat on defense, which you always like to pick up those defensive scores. So, I mean, I think he is a high-value pick, which would really fit well for the Jaguars if they were able to get him.
Yeah, and I think a dark horse pick you could see him take would be Reuben Foster out of Alabama, the middle linebacker.
Right.
Because Paul Fuzzbrook needs about 32 now, and they'll need someone to take his place there soon. And Miles Jack is a little quicker, so they can have him at weak side linebacker.
Right. Yeah, I would say that when you look at it, what was your feelings about Dante Fowler? Did he live up to expectations after missing his first year due to injury?
Well, if you watch his tape, he has a really high motor. You could tell he's one of the hardest working people on the field. But I read this the other day. They said his problem is he just has no hand technique. So it's not like the physicality is there. It's just he really needs to work on his technique.
Right, right. So would you let's play devil's advocate. If they were to trade down, and let's say they go with Solomon Thomas out of Stanford, could you see them going with, or where do you see them going in the early second round?
Early second round, if they don't pick a tight end, there's two different tight ends I could see them pick, and you have Evan Engram out of Ole Miss, and
right.
David Njoku out of Miami. I think if they don't take a tight end in the first, they definitely be at the top of the second.
How do you feel about George Kittle of Iowa?
I actually have not watched any tape on, so I really couldn't give you any answers on that.
And if they want defense, you know, if let's say they did not go with Malik Hooker in that early pick, when they came back around, you know, a couple guys of interest, and I'm going to kill their names here, but I'm going to give it a shot anyhow. They have the safety from Connecticut, Obi Melifuano, who is 6'4", 220 pounds. He gets a lot of favorable comparisons to Cam Chancellor. Could you see your guys going with him?
Yeah, at the top of the second, I could see that. I see the first two picks. If I were the GM, it would be offensive.
Okay.
The top needs I have right now is offensive line for tight end and then running back. And with it being such a deep draft with the running back, I could see him also going with running back at the top of the second, too.
Sure. And, of course, you've got, besides Fournette, you have Christian McCaffrey, who is viewed as a multi-purpose back, as is Dalvin Cook from Florida State. An interesting one that I have seen associated with the Jaguars is Joe Mixon out of Oklahoma. How do you feel about Mixon? Because he comes with some baggage.
I mean, outside of the politics with it, I think he's a great player. I think he would probably be a first-round pick. So I think you're getting a great value pick if you do take that chance at second taking him, but you're going to get a lot of scrutiny for it.
Sure. And if he turns out to be a good player, of course, the Jaguars look like geniuses. And if he goes and hits another woman, then they're going to say, why'd you pick this guy? Because you knew about his history.
Exactly.
Okay.
And,
well,
Jim, I mean,
go ahead.
Yep.
Well, we're running up against the time here. So I thank you for coming on. Of course, our draft is going to be on April 23rd. From 1 to 4, and will be broadcast on WALH 106.7 FM, WZAA 106.9 FM, and, of course, on the internet, talktv.us. So we look forward to talking to you at that time, and we'll find out who the Jaguars are going to take here in a few weeks.
Yep. Thanks for having me on.
And that is J.J. Raback making the picks for the Jacksonville Jaguars.
So far, some interesting analysis and insight from some of the people that we've had on here as far as the discussions here. We want to remind everybody we are at Fiesta Veracruz Mexican Restaurant, 37 West Locust Street in Wilmington, Ohio. And their number is 937-382-1734. And, of course, we are streaming and broadcasting over WALH 106.7 FM and also WZAA 106.9 and TalkTV.com, as Bill related. I guess we'll be ready for Tim Fillinger here at the top of the hour now that we've gotten our first hour of the Campus Nation Sports Planet under our belt, Bill.
And we've got four more GMs coming up. We're trying to get all these guys on in the next few weeks before the draft actually kicks off, so that at least, you know, what do you think out there? I'm sure you all have your favorite teams. Of course, this area is a strong Bengals area. Mark Scovanner will be on next week. He's going to give us his 2 cents worth about his feelings about the Bengals and which way they may go. So, you know, we're going to take a deeper look and see where these teams will go. But, you know, we'd love to have your opinion if you're in the area and you want to stop in here at Fiesta Veracruz. And we've got the legend here.
Yeah, the legend has finally arrived.
He is
no longer running the board making a sound great, but there is someone. Got to turn your microphone on there.
And we have the legendary Lee Hendy here with us tonight.
You got it, Lee?
What are we talking about?
What do we usually talk about, Lee? Is it usually
football?
Oh, either Ohio State.
Are you ready for some football, Lee?
Or I heard you talking about Cleveland Browns.
Well, Mike Fritz came on, and we relived that nightmare a few years ago when we had the draft on.
I heard you even mention Johnny Manziel. You had to bring that up, didn't you?
I do. It scarred me, Lee, when that happened that night.
Johnny Football.
Johnny Football.
Where is he at now? Is he working at Walmart someplace? Or what?
I think he's a greeter, yeah.
I think that he's working on the Mean Machine, or he's working on the Burt Reynolds remake.
There you go.
Adam Sandler remade with The Longest Yard. It's going to be
the shortest yard for him. Well, but he never got anywhere.
No, he didn't get very tall either. So, and
fun drinking.
Yeah,
we get that.
Yeah. Hello. Tim Fillinger. This is
yes, hi, Bill.
The one, the only Tim Fillinger.
Tim
right?
Fillinger, sure. One of our regular contributors here on WALH
from Cleveland, but obviously a Packers fan, right?
Yes.
From way back.
Okay.
Back
season. Yeah, the one and only, and one is more than enough.
Back to the.
I wasn't going to say that, yeah. Tim.
Back to the old Vince Lombardi days there.
Yeah, there you go.
John Facenda used to come on and start talking about the frozen turf of Lambeau Field.
Well, you know, it's curious that you mention this because although I'm dating myself here a bit, the very first NFL championship game I remember watching was in 1965 when the Packers beat the Cleveland Browns.
Yep.
In Lambeau Field.
Yeah, that was
on the frozen tundra.
Frozen tundra. And, of course, the Packers had a pretty good run there because they would come back in 66 and 67 and add the first Super Bowl victories on top of that NFL title in 65.
Yeah, that's true.
And, of course, then and Rick and I just talked a little bit about Joe Willie Namath predicted the upset of the Baltimore Colts, which pretty much sealed the deal on a merger between the AFL and NFL.
Plus, Joe looked great in pantyhose, too.
Yes, he did.
And he liked fur coats also.
That's right. Yeah.
That all worried me. But
little do people know that Joe Namath was probably the first and most famous transgender athlete.
Well, you know,
heartbreaking.
He was ahead of his time by
yes, he was
for sure. Tim, looking at the Packers, they lost J.C. Treader in free agency. They lost Eddie Lacy in free agency. Did they pick anybody up? I mean, did they improve themselves? What's your feeling about the losses, and did they pick somebody up that is going to fill some of that, or you think they're going to wait for the draft?
Well, a combination. And an even bigger loss that you didn't mention was T.J. Lang was one of their starting guards.
Right.
And what's really significant about that is they lost him within their division to the Detroit Lions.
Right. And
But Packers have tried to move on from there. They did sign Don Barclay, a free agent guard. They signed Justin McCray, also a free agent guard. And I look for them to try to add some more offensive linemen in the draft.
Okay. Eddie Lacy has been, I would refrain from calling him a spectacular running back, but he has definitely been a serviceable, dependable back. You think that they will look in the draft to fill that need, or is that going to be maybe something with a later, you know, there'll be another round of free agency after the draft when people cut other players. Do you feel that they may go in that direction?
That's quite possible. They did sign Christine Michael as a free agent running back. And also, they do have some interest in Stanford running back Christian McCaffrey in the draft.
Okay.
Now, whether they pick him with the 29th pick in the first round or whether McCaffrey is still available in the second round, and they may pick him at that point.
Right. I'm going to pull this up here, and we've got Green Bay And they have them, pretty much like you were saying, going with Forrest Lamp, who is the top-rated guard in the draft.
People named Forrest do pretty well out there in Green Bay.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, they do.
The shining beacon for his quarterback.
They had the Forrest Gregg out there, so maybe this will be the reincarnation with Forrest Lamp. Another gentleman has them taking Tees Tabor from Florida, the cornerback.
Right.
Charles Harris, the defensive end from Missouri. And the third projection has them taking Taco Charlton, the defensive end from Michigan. So they're kind of all over the board. Two of them, of course, or actually three defense and one offensive line, which would kind of go along with what you were saying.
Yeah, and, you know, the Packers do need to address both areas, the offensive line and the defensive side of the ball.
Sure do.
A couple of projections that I saw. If he's still available in the first round, they may pick Marlon Humphrey out of Alabama as the cornerback.
And that would
but he may go a few picks before they're even on the board. So
sure, you know, looking at the board, that we see Christian McCaffrey actually landing in a couple places according to these mock drafts. But the one place they do have him landing is Kansas City, because of course they lost Lamar Charles,
right?
And so that would be interesting to see if they go in that direction. You know,
another person that the Packers have been looking at seriously is P.J. Watt, linebacker out of Wisconsin, younger brother to J.J. Watt,
right?
The Texans,
and you know that they do a lot of the teams that are in the. The colder regions in the north, they like to bring players from schools where they've been playing in the cold weather.
Yeah.
Because sometimes when you bring a guy from Miami or Alabama, no matter how much you're paying them, they don't adjust well to the weather.
That's true.
Send somebody from Florida State to Cleveland or Green Bay, they could have a little adjustment time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, you know,
big time adjustment.
And you think about it, really, when you talk about crossover games in college, if you ever see an SEC Big Ten crossover game, it's always early in the year.
Yeah.
They rarely, if ever, come up to the north. And I believe that Ohio State and Tennessee had a deal for a late November game a few years ago, which basically just kind of fell apart.
Yeah.
And I think that might have been more that Tennessee didn't want to come up here in the middle of a snowstorm.
Well, I think they were still waiting on a new shipment of shoes to be imported into the state.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, there is a connection there. So, you know, you talked about them taking the lineman Lang. Or rather, Lions did. And I had heard that, you know, one of the things that we don't think about, and we saw the Browns do this with the Zeitler kid from Cincinnati, is that quite often teams will sign free agents from teams in their own division because of the fact that they know the other, I mean, scheme-wise, they know the teams they're going to be playing. And so, and also we talked about weather. So if they're playing, although you're going from Green Bay to Detroit, who plays in a dome.
Yeah.
But it seems that makes a lot of sense for the Lions to try to do something like that.
Yeah.
Well, sure. They not only strengthen themselves, but they weaken one of their division rivals at the same time.
Right.
The Browns, as a matter of fact, had a little bit of success a few years back. They signed Terry Steinbach, guard out of Cincinnati.
Yep.
And he had a pretty productive 3 or 4 years up here.
Yeah, until he got an injury, he was pretty good for the Browns. But, yeah, you know, the Packers, they're one of the traditional franchises. I think, you know, they were kind of a mystery. As the year started, they did not look very good. They were one of my early picks to play the Seahawks in the NFC Championship, and I had them playing New England in the Super Bowl.
Yeah, as did I.
And I didn't see them. They came on at the end of the year, but there has been rumor about things not being the greatest in the locker room with Aaron Rodgers. What can you say about that?
Well, I just read something recently within the last week or so that Rodgers has been pretty upbeat this last couple of weeks going into the new season, and that he thinks that the Green Bay fans are going to be in for a real good, enjoyable season from them.
Well, for Green Bay's sake, I hope so.
Well, I'm sorry, go ahead.
I'm like you, Tim. They've got to fix both offensive and defensive lines. They've got to give Aaron Rodgers some protection back there because he was getting killed for a while last year.
Well, sure, and that had a lot to do with their inconsistency early on in their bad stretch, too.
No doubt.
That coupled with going without Jordy Nelson, their top receiver, for really the first third or half of the season.
Yeah. I don't care how good you are, if that quarterback, if you can't have time back there and you don't have anybody to get rid of the ball to, you got a major problem.
That's true. And, you know, on the flip side of that, teams have proven in the past that they can win with an average quarterback if they put a good line and good pieces around him. A few years ago, the Ravens won. I'm trying to remember the quarterback's name. He was basically a journeyman.
Trent Dilfer,
that's correct, yeah.
Trent Dilfer was truly the ultimate game manager, and he knew his role. He came in and played well. Of course, we know that Aaron Rodgers is a lot more than a game manager, and when he's on, there's nobody better in the league.
That's true, but just as was just commented on, he's got to have some protection. I mean, the best of quarterbacks, they're going to be beaten up in a hurry if they don't have a good line in front of them.
I think the line thing, we saw a little bit of that with the Green Bay Atlanta game. They just did not play very well. They got kind of chewed up by Atlanta in that game. And I think that was maybe a glaring deficiency that said, hey, you need to replace those guys if you're right. Going to be competitive with the younger teams in the league.
Yeah, I think that is true.
Well, Tim, we're up against it. As always, thanks for coming on WALH, WZAA, and TalkTV.us. Of course, April 23rd will be the draft right here on these networks.
That's right.
And it will be from 1 to 4, and you will be selecting for the Green Bay Packers, and we appreciate you coming on tonight and sharing your knowledge about the draft.
Well, guys, thanks for having me.
And that's Tim Villinger from Cleveland picking for the Packers. So, Lee, this is going to be the third year we did this.
That's right.
And
we're getting almost as many networks and stations involved in this as that four-letter network.
Yeah, that's
right. A couple
more
years.
Is that the mouse we're talking about? The mouse?
Yeah.
The mouse, yeah.
The Espen?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Those guys.
Well, you know, we've been pretty good. I think our first year we were correct on 18 out of the 32 picks.
Yeah.
And I believe last year we were a little bit off that. I think we were at 17. But we've been over 50% correct. And, of course, we don't allow trades in our draft.
No.
So we can never tell how teams are going to, you know, move up and down, which kind of throws us off. But we have had some good success, and we hope to continue to do that.
Absolutely. Who all have you got so far as in the draft, as far as
GMs?
GMs.
Well, we picked up Trey Sackstetter, who is the manager at MC Sports.
Okay.
He grew up in Indiana. Well, he actually was born in Columbus, moved to Indiana, and had come back here to the Wilmington area.
Okay.
And grew up a Titans fan because of Eddie George.
All right. Not bad.
And so he's continued to be a fan of that franchise. We had J.J. Raybeck on, who, of course, grew up in Florida, and at the time of the inception of the franchise of the Panthers, the Panthers and Jaguars, and he, at a very young age, started wearing all this Jaguar stuff, and
imagine that
has continued to be a Jaguars fan.
Tim Fillon. They've had hard times here in the last few years, so they'll be back.
Tom Coughlin's there. I think Tom Coughlin can correct things for them. Coughlin, of course, took them to the AFC Championship right. in their third year. So you got to think that they'll move in the right direction.
Right. Right, they'll get there eventually. I want to be Mike Brown because I want to be the guy that gets to keep all the money, not spend any.
Do they make any money?
I don't know if they do.
They're always crying
poor. Keeping it all. Yeah. Nobody else is getting any.
So we got the Vikings coming up, right? With Chris.
Chris Ruth is going to talk about the Vikings. Of course, last year Lee did the Chicago Bears.
Yeah, I did.
And
maybe now we can go get a quarterback.
You're not going to bring back Jake. You're not going to bring back Jay Cutler?
No. It's Jake from Cleveland
State Farm.
From the Chicago Bears. Bye, Jake.
Well, you guys did pick up Mike Glennon.
Well, yeah, but
from Tampa Bay. That's the guy I was hoping that Cleveland would pursue. And I think he will prove to be a pretty decent quarterback.
Do we have Chris on?
Chris? Yes.
There he is.
And we have Chris Fruth from the Toledo area, who is participating as the Minnesota GM here on WALH 106.7.
Mike Zimmer.
Mike Zimmer, right. WZAA 106.9.
Yeah.
And TalkTV.us.
Right.
So
the Mega Network.
Yes, the Mega Network. Chris, welcome tonight. We're going to talk about the Vikings. How do you think things have went? It's been kind of a different offseason for the Vikings.
Oh, you're being kind, my friend. and glad to hear from you again. From Lucky, Ohio.
From Lucky, Ohio, which is outside of Toledo.
So what they've done is they've lost both their offensive tackles.
That's
and so they've also lost Adrian Peterson.
Yes, that's a big part.
They lost a wide receiver and possibly a defensive tackle to nerve damage on the knee.
Yeah, I just heard that today that he may be done.
Yeah, not good.
So the Vikings go from being a very promising playoff ready franchise to where they're really struggling right now. I mean, and they lost one of those linemen to a divisional opponent in the Detroit Lions.
Yes.
Did they pick anybody up in free agency? Are there some players, are there some bright spots there, some hope for Vikings fans?
Well, in all honesty, I don't know if there's a lot of hope. But they did pick up Riley Reiff from Detroit as an offensive tackle.
So they just exchanged linemen, right?
Yes, they exchanged linemen. They picked up a Arena League tight end named Nick Truesdell, I guess his name is.
Right.
And they picked up a cornerback, Terrell Sinkfield, from Northern Illinois.
Okay, so Reiff I've heard of, and I think he's a quality lineman. He's one of the considered one of the above average tackles in the league. So because they lost Lang, so it's just kind of replacing one with the other.
True.
So we move forward. Is there someone out, I mean, in the free agents that are still remaining or some that are potential like Tony Romo, who nothing's happened with him yet, is there someone out there that you'd like to see the Vikings go after to bolster a depleted roster at this point?
Wow, that's a loaded question there, Bill.
Well, I know there's a lot of guys out there, but I didn't know if there was a name, maybe somebody you sit there and say, man, I wish the Vikings would, you know, take a run at this guy because maybe he could fill some of the gaps for us. I mean, like running back. How are they going to address the loss of Adrian Peterson?
They already have, sort of. They've signed Latavius Murray, previously of Oakland.
I forgot. And yes, Latavius Murray, who was a 1,000-yard running back for the Raiders this past year. So that's a nice pickup for them. I think maybe an equal pickup, because in the last few years, Peterson hasn't been the Peterson that came into the league.
Right.
I agree.
When you look at the draft, well, let's talk about your quarterback situation. You've got Sam Bradford, who has been hurt for a good part of his career. I think he played well for you guys this past season. Of course, Teddy Bridgewater is sitting there. What do you hear about Bridgewater? Is there a chance he's going to be back this year, or is it that it's Sam Bradford's team maybe for another year?
I'm thinking based on what I've seen, Teddy Bridgewater's injury was significant. And he was really coming into his own when he did get injured.
Right.
And there's really no timetable the way it looks.
Okay. So they're just going to have some patience.
Bradford's team.
Yeah. Is there a chance that the Vikings will look quarterback? Because, of course, Sam Bradford is no longer young. Teddy
I did not see that coming out. I think they're looking for offensive line depth.
Okay.
Defensive tackle and defensive backfield.
That being said, let's look at the draft. Where do you see them going?
Based on all my information as a GM, they're looking at a center guard from LSU.
Okay.
They don't pick until the 48th pick, so they're going to get a mid-second round pick.
Right, right. Yeah, I noticed that they had traded away their first round pick. So yeah, they are going to be in a somewhat tough situation, to say the least.
Yeah, so I'm looking at offensive line first, maybe a quality defensive tackle coming out of the draft.
Okay.
And pick up maybe a running back, and then shore up their defensive backfield.
Okay.
Because when you have Terrence Newman as a starting cornerback, you really need to shore up your defensive backfield.
Yeah. And that being said about corners, we see, you know, Marshawn Lattimore of Ohio State and Marlon Humphrey of Alabama are most commonly mentioned. But maybe someone like Garyon Conley from Ohio State could drop to the Vikings there at that 48 spot.
You know, I'd love to see that if I was the GM of the Minnesota Vikings.
You are.
But based on what I'm...
You can pick anybody you
want. That's right, just pick anybody.
You're using their money right
take
now,
them
Chris, so you can take whoever you want.
Okay, so in my world of fantasy here,
yes,
I would love to pick up Garyon Conley from Ohio State. There you go.
Okay. Well, that would be a solid pick for him.
We'll cut you the check.
And you get a free trip to Minneapolis in the middle of February, by the way.
Oh, boy.
take
your... All of America, here I come, baby.
Here you go.
Just take body armor with you if you go to Mall of America.
Oh, good Lord.
Did I drag in the razor's edge there a little bit? We do that. We're going to be resurrecting Razor's Edge here in a few weeks. So, we'll get out of that. You know, we'll drift back to the football for a second. But anybody? I mean, you know, I'm looking at some of the tackles. Ryan Ramczyk from Wisconsin is going to be gone before the Vikings pick. Garrett Bowles, most likely, he's the. You know, I see some draft boards with Garrett Bowles the. Offensive tackle out of Utah now jumping Ramczyk basically because they say he's more athletic and they said he has a real mean streak in him. He's a very aggressive Conrad, you know, I'm going to show my age here, a Conrad Dobler kind of player where he said he's got that certain nastiness to him that makes him a real commodity. But that would be nice if he would drop. You know, I don't know if he'll be around when the Vikings pick, but one guy that's a huge offensive tackle. He's a little bit of a project. Is Antonio Gates from Troy University, and supposedly maybe long range potential. This kid has the best potential.
Well, if that's the case, then a second round draft pick, that would be a perfect pick for the Vikings.
Yeah. And, of course, that's, you know, pretty much where they've got to go. And, well, Chris, we are up against it. We're going to be in a transition period here where we're going to move to one of the other GMs. But I appreciate you coming on here on WALH 106.7, WZAA 106.9, and, of course, TalkTV.us on the Internet, sharing your great knowledge about the Minnesota Vikings as their GM. And, we will be talking with you here in April as the draft rolls by and we get ready for it.
All right. Well, thank you so much, Bill.
And that is Chris. Yeah, go ahead.
He's off. He's gone.
And that's Chris Fruth calling from Lucky, Ohio, which is a...
Lucky. Didn't we have one of those here in Wilmington? Or was that something else?
That was a lucky... Lucky Cloverleaf or something
like that. Lucky you?
Yeah.
They weren't too lucky, were they?
No, they weren't.
Yeah, they were lucky up near WZAA either.
That's right.
Well, yeah. That's true.
Of course, they weren't actually in where we are placing our studio, but they were just down from us.
Wasn't that the Lucky Shamrock, I think, is what it was called.
No, it was a Lucky You.
Lucky You.
Oh, was it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Lucky or
you.
Unlucky You, as they probably call it now.
It turned out they were unlucky.
Yeah. Very unlucky. But
yeah,
you
know,
anyway,
who we got up next year with...
Right. We're going to bring in Steve Smith. We've got two numbers for him. I assume we'll try the first number.
Yeah, the 567 or 561 number.
Did he play for the Baltimore Ravens?
Well, he
retired.
Yeah, he played for the Panthers too.
Things,
This Steve Smith, he lives in West Palm Beach.
Oh, such a terrible place to stay.
Yeah, we have to give him a hard time about the weather down there.
You don't know anything about that place.
So we want to remind everybody that we are coming live from Fiesta Veracruz Mexican Restaurant, even though we sound like we're recorded. 37 West Locust Street right here in Wilmington, Ohio, 937-382-1734. I know we've got a little bit of bad weather coming in, but you can probably get in and see us all here before the weather gets
here. Folks are rolling in as we are on.
Yeah, it looks a little cloudy back there.
Yeah,
but at least you guys are between me and the shards of glass that'll be flying as the hurricane or tornado hits.
Thanks for
so do we
that.
Get our tennis It'll, match in tomorrow, guys? What do you think? Is it going
to... I don't think that there'll be our baseball game with the Wilmington Hurricane probably will not make it tomorrow, but just not to keep looking at the website and see if you can...
Yeah.
And of course,
the bad weather's supposed to get here like in the afternoon again tomorrow.
Right. We want to remind everybody that the video on TalkTV.us from tonight's...
With our smiling faces.
That's right. We'll be on our website tomorrow evening, so you can go to the TalkTV.us website and actually see
the folks back home.
The Campus Nation Sports Planet, right? They are live. They're not recorded.
Yes. Well, we may not look live. We might be just androids sitting here. But
that's right. So tune in tomorrow night to the website, and you'll be able to see the great video of these characters that we've got here. Lee Hindy, the legend from WALH 106.7, and Bill Raybeck of many different hats, including the Razor's Edge, which is our politically motivated show. And then, of course, yours truly, Rick Phillips. I try to make everybody sound as good as we can make
them
sound.
Rick does a great job of that.
All sound good.
Yeah. And, of course... we hope that the Razor's Edge will return here.
I think once we get the studio up and operating, we should be taking possession of the studio this next week. Lease has all been hammered out. It involved a tower for our radio station. It involved a tower to be brought in later for bandwidth.
Bulletproof glass so we can say anything we want, right?
That's right. Right. We'll have bulletproof glass, and it'll be mirrored so you can't really see it.
We just make sure we keep the front door locked.
Right. And we will direct them to the other address, which probably will turn out to be Buckeye Country or something like that.
Somebody like that, yeah.
Kind of diversion there.
Kind of like Tom Baudet. We'll keep the light on
for
him there.
We'll keep the light on for you.
So I'll get a hold of Steve Smith here, and we'll bring him in to talk
to
the Dolphins.
Here while,
yes, the Dolphins. Lee, did you see the article in the News Journal about the Wilmington College women's basketball
team?
Yeah,
they're on a Costa Rica trip.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
That'd be rather interesting down there.
And Mike Snar is Maybe we'll get Mike.
He always gets to go on those trips. He doesn't have anything to do with soccer, but he gets to go anyhow.
Yeah.
He must be their foreign ambassador from Wilmington
College.
He must be.
Well, maybe we can get...
But it's basketball, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right.
Well, maybe we could get Mike on and in the coming weeks.
That.
And I know Rick knows him. And maybe we'll talk to Mike about that trip, and he can fill us in and maybe promote it a little bit here locally.
There you go. Yeah.
So we will hope that... have him on. And
you were talking about Tony Romo. I just saw, and everything on the internet is true, of course, but
of course
I saw where the Cowboys re-signed him for another big fat 5-year contract.
Well, I've heard two things. I've heard that Fox and CBS, Steve Smith.
Hello?
Yes.
There he is.
There he is.
He was just listening to the interesting conversation.
Yeah, he was just listening to the in-depth analysis. Steve, this is Bill Rayback. I'm joined by Lee Hendy and Rick Phillips here. You are on...
Hey, how are you doing?
Good. We're doing fine. We're broadcasting live on WALH 106.7, WZAA 106.9, and, of course, on the internet, talktv.us. Steve, you were our GM last year for the... ironically, since you live in West Palm Beach, for the Philadelphia Eagles. But this year, you get to pick for your home team, the Miami Dolphins. And why don't you talk a little bit about what the Dolphins have done in the offseason, maybe acquisitions and losses that they've had?
Sure. Well, start off with our key losses were Issa Abdul-Kaddous, him getting hurt. We had to waive him. I thought he was really productive at the safety position.
Okay.
Nobody's going to miss Mario Williams. Really thought when he came in he was going to be good, but didn't happen.
Other than a couple places, he's been kind of struck out. He's got a lot of money in, Buffalo and down in Miami, and he really didn't produce like everybody thought he would.
No, I thought he was going to be more productive in our defensive scheme rather than in Buffalo. But it just didn't pan out. Looked like he took a lot of plays off. Like you said, he probably just took the money.
Yep. And that kills the drive in a lot of them when they start getting the big paychecks.
Sure.
Who else did the Dolphins... let's talk about the additions, people that they may have added through the free agency avenue.
Oh, they did a great job getting rid of Brandon Albert, Mr. Glass, at tackle.
Mr. Glass.
Yeah, I called him that last year, too.
Yeah.
And I wasn't unfounded. We got Julius Thomas in a trade day.
That'll be a nice pickup for you.
Absolutely. I mean, he was very productive under Adam Gase when he played for Denver.
Yep.
So I think he can get the same production out of it.
Yep.
And then of course, we got the number one run block tight end back to the fold, Anthony Fasano.
So the Dolphins were a playoff team.
Yep.
They were absent for quite a few years. They've made the necessary adjustments to get back to the playoffs. Where do you see them needing to add to get to the next level, to win a couple playoff games, maybe get to the AFC Championship and possibly the Super Bowl?
Well, they were on the right track last year. Look at Tannehill's production the last 8 or 9 games before he got hurt. If he doesn't get hurt, we're right there.
Right.
I truly believe that. So not a lot of holes. I mean, we addressed a couple with Lawrence Simmons coming in, with Nate Allen coming in. I like the Nate Allen signing.
Okay.
He's a local boy.
Do you we look at the draft, and I'm going to read some names because I'm on an ESPN site, and they have numerous experts, in air quotes there, that have projected the Dolphins. One guy has them taking Hassan Riddick, the defensive end from Temple, who has been favorably compared to Khalil Mack of the Raiders.
Wow.
How would you feel about that?
I would love that. That guy's got a 4.5, 240, and he's 231 pounds. He might be a little light right now, but so was Cameron Wake.
Yeah, and I think they, you know, you get to the NFL, they have a way of putting that 15 or 20 pounds on you.
Right, exactly. I mean, he can definitely play in space on first and second down, and he's got the motor to run after the quarterback on third.
Sure. Another guy they have listed here is linebacker T.J. Watt, the brother of J.J. Watt.
I think he is going to slip. I think his numbers are comparable to the Watt in college, but he doesn't have that same
motor.
You know, right, the motor, right. I think he's going to drop down out of the first round.
Right.
I like Tack McKinley.
Okay.
If he's still there at 22, that would be a nice move because he's a speed rusher. He's got long arms. He can do that deep bend.
You know, I've seen Reuben Foster, the linebacker from Alabama's name associated with the Dolphins. How do you feel about that, especially with the lack of total success of Alabama players? You know, it's kind of a crapshoot because Nick Saban really gets so much out of them during their 4 or 5 years at Alabama that a lot of times they say they come in and they're all used up before they ever step on an NFL field.
Well, I don't know if you can say that. Look at Dante Hightower.
Well, no, I'm saying that they've had, what I'm saying is it's kind of a crapshoot where some of them have just kind of disappeared once they've got to the NFL because of the fact that, you know, they've just got, Nick gets a pound of flesh out of them when they're at Alabama. So does that concern you with somebody like Reuben Foster? Do you think because of the position in that wouldn't be a consideration?
You're right. It is 50-50 when you look at the list.
Right.
But I don't think he's going to be available at 22. I think he's going to go earlier. He does have a lot of intangibles. Now, he did have the issue where he yelled at the trainer at the combine.
And
I think he could do well.
Yeah, well, I'm just kind of scrolling through here, and I see him. One guy's got him going 11 to the Saints, and then another guy's got him going 13 to the Cardinals, and then I even saw his name down with the Colts at 15. So you're right; he is seems to be a popular commodity, a little bit above where the Dolphins are going to be picking.
Right. What about the Alabama guy that I do want is Cam Ruff.
Yeah, and then now that would be a nice pickup. I think it would keep Tannehill upright a little bit more if you were able to get him.
Absolutely, and he can play tackle or guard wherever you want to put it.
And, of course, you know, you can always groom him. To be a left tackle in the NFL takes a little bit. There's a learning curve involved with that. It's not an easy thing to step in there and get the speed rushes that you see in the NFL because every one of those guys is probably a former linebacker or somebody that's got great feet. So it's really a difficult position to fill in the NFL.
Well, you got our guy Tunsil who came in and did a great job there.
Yes, yes.
So I think that's why they were able to move Albert.
Sure.
Because he's going to slide right in and do that. But put him next to him. Put Robinson next to him at guard at 322 pounds.
And you got a.
And I think that's a good,
good offensive line.
Good bulldozer there. Yeah, exactly.
Cover a lot of territory east and west.
Yes, he does. He doesn't miss.
Yes,
too
he
many,
does.
Doesn't miss too many meals. Another name I saw come up for the Dolphins was Tre'Davious White, the corner out of LSU.
Okay. And
tight end, and I'm going to kill this guy's last name, David Njoku from Miami?
University of Miami. I've also seen that in mock drafts. I wouldn't be happy with that. If O.J. Howard's available, you're taking O.J. Howard over him.
Right. And it is a deep draft for tight ends, so I guess the question would be, you know, Howard is kind of, he wildly fluctuates. You know, you see him in the top 10, which is unusual for tight ends, but then again, running backs usually don't go in the top 10 either. So,
right.
It's, you know, if that kind of athlete comes along, if he ends up being the kind of threat, 6'6" threat that you can put down and match him up with smaller safeties, we've seen what New England's been able to do with Gronk doing that.
Yeah.
And, you know, if he would be there, he'd be a great addition for you guys.
Absolutely.
When you look at your running game, any concern there, or you feel pretty good there, or would you like to see him pick somebody up in that area?
Feeling good with Ajayi and Drake, and we re-signed Damian Williams, which I think he's a good change of pace guy.
Right.
But, yeah, I mean, there are some running backs out there that still could be had on the free agent wire.
Right. Well, Jai was, you know, in college, obviously, he is a very attractive commodity, and I think, you know, he definitely stepped up for you guys and would be a guy that hopefully you can depend on for the next 5, 6, 7 years.
We're hoping. I mean, he's got very shaky knees, but
right.
We'll see how it goes for the next two.
Yeah, you got to take him one
day. Remember what happened with Lamar Smith after we ran him into the ground.
Right. What about, we're going to close up here with Ryan Tannehill. Do you see maybe in the later rounds them moving to, you know, maybe start looking for a younger backup, maybe somebody that they can groom to be the heir apparent there?
Well, I think we saw a lot of good stuff out of Brandon Dowdy in the offseason.
Okay.
And I think that would probably be the guy right now that's going to supplant him if, you know, he's a seventh round pick from Western Kentucky. But I thought he showed a lot of good skills in preseason last year.
Sure. He's got a live arm, no doubt about it.
Right.
Steve, we look forward to you joining us on April 23rd for the NFL mock draft. This will be our third year. And, of course, you get to pick your hometown team this year, which will be good.
Yes.
And so I thank you for being on WALH, WZAA, and TalkTV.us tonight, giving us your insight on what the Dolphins are going to do.
One thing you asked me was if there was a free agent out there that's still looking for a job that we could bring him into the fold.
Yes.
And I'd like to make a personal plea, because he may be listening. It's one of your Ohio State guys. It's Jonathan Hankins.
Yes.
Come on down. We got no state tax.
The water's fine.
Yeah.
And Dominican Sue will be right next to you. He'll free you up. You can go rush the passer.
There you go. Well, I hope he's listening, Steve, to your plea. And
I hope so, too.
It's got to be a lot warmer than New York, so I would think you get a lot of New York snowbirds that come down, or maybe Hankins will be one of them.
Okay.
Exactly.
Okay. Well, thanks, Steve, for joining us tonight.
All right. Have a great night, guys.
Thanks. And that, of course, is Steve Smith with the Miami Dolphins.
And God, he wasn't a guy from Buffalo.
No. He retired before him.
Yeah.
And, of course, you're listening to the Campus Nation Sports Planet. We've got the legend, Lee Hindy. And, of course, our host, Bill Raybeck. Yours truly, Rick Phillips. We're going into our last 15-minute segment here with Scott Wilcox. We'll get him on the line. He's going to be talking about the Kansas City Chiefs.
He will be talking live from Kansas City about the Chiefs. And Scott,
what better place to talk about them, right?
That's right. Yeah, we got somebody from that town, so it's nice to get the ones. Of course, we had Steve from Miami, and then we'll have Scott here in Kansas City. So we will have some input on that. Kansas City is kind of an interesting situation. Lamar Charles, of course, got released. A lot of that probably had to do with the injury bug.
Yeah.
I think that one of the things the Chiefs will definitely have to look at is Alex Smith has been around, believe it or not,
forever.
12 years now, I think. He played for Urban at Utah and was the number one draft choice of the 49ers before going there. And he has been successful, so I think at some point they have to start thinking about that replacement.
This is Scott.
Here we
Scott,
go.
This is Bill Rayback here at WALH, WZAA, and TalkTV.us, of course, on the internet. I'm joined by Lee Hendy and Rick Phillips tonight. And how are you?
Good, doing great. How are you, Bill?
Well, I've had a great night. We've been talking football here for 2 hours with a bunch of guys that are posing as the dream job NFL
posers.
We're posers.
Kind of like us posing as radio people, right?
Yeah, well, that's right. I mean, everybody poses as something here. You know, it's kind of like being a Hollywood star, I guess. You're who you are, really aren't.
Yeah.
But, Scott, you're doing the Chiefs.
Yes.
They've had an interesting offseason, to say the least. Some key people have, particularly Lamar Charles, has moved. Why don't you talk a little bit about some of the losses and maybe some of the free agency acquisitions that you guys have been able to make?
Well, the big one was Jamal Charles, obviously. You know, the guy had two very bad knee injuries. It was really difficult for them to bring him back and totally understand that he'll someday be in the Chiefs Hall of Fame. But, you know, it was a business decision, and they had to do it.
Right.
The other one, the one big loss was Don Carry-Pole, who ended up signing a one-year deal with the Falcons.
Right.
But they were fortunate enough to replace him. And, you know, basically they're looking at from the 22 starters off of a 12-4 team from last year, they're only going to be replacing one new starter, at least on paper, is what it appears.
Right. And, you know, looking at the Chiefs the last couple of years, I've felt defensively they've stacked up with anybody in the league. You had that one acquisition that you guys picked up last year. His name escapes me, but he's one of the fastest guys in the NFL.
The cornerback, yes.
Yeah, I mean...
No, I'm sorry. You're talking about the wide receiver, former Oklahoma State wide receiver. Lord.
Tiny guy, little kick returner for you in that. Just a really...
Tyreek Hill.
Yeah,
and he ended up getting some trouble at Oklahoma State and ended up transferring to West Alabama.
Right.
And, Lord, the kid was just explosion in a bottle. He really added a new dimension to the special team.
I remember watching him, I think it was against the Steelers, and I could not, he looked like a video game player, like you had Turbo, because he just accelerated and ran away from everybody on the field.
Yeah, supposedly he was the fastest man in the NFL last year. They would run a lot of jet sweep with him.
Yes.
And it was just unbelievable how quickly he could get up to speed.
He convinced me, because when you see him run away from NFL corners, who are generally some of the fastest guys in the league, you know you've got a pretty fast kid there.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was pulling away, too.
So we look at the... free agents and that and what you guys have done, you feel good about that? Is there some people that may be still out there that you would like to see them bring in or plug some holes before the draft?
You know, as I said, I'm probably told it's a big loss, defensive tackle. He fought back injuries the last 2 years. And they did sign Ben Hogan from the Eagles. It was just a one-year deal, but Don Carry-Pole signed for $8 million with the Falcons. The Chiefs signed Logan for $8 million. They're both on one-year deals. And basically, if you look at the staff, Logan and Poe are basically the exact same tape player from a defensive standpoint, statistical standpoint, I should say. And we got a little bit younger, healthier version in Logan than what we gave up, you know, with Poe.
Right.
But they had to make a decision whether to put the franchise tag on him, and they just didn't do it. So I think it's at least a wash, and if nothing, something in the Chiefs' benefit.
So you go into the draft.
Mm-hmm.
You look at your moves, you look at your deletions. Where do you see Kansas City going with that 27th pick? I mean, I'm looking at a couple mock drafts on ESPN, and I see some interesting names, and if I think the Chiefs would be really pleased if they get some of these guys. You first talk about who you would like, and I'll lay these names on you and see how you would feel, how they would fit with Kansas City.
Okay, well, let me ask you guys a trivia question first.
Okay.
Is there a present or something? Do we win? Do we win something if we get this right?
Exactly.
Like maybe a first-round draft choice or something like that?
Do we get Rice-A-Roni, the San Francisco treat?
There you go.
How about some Kansas City barbecue?
Oh, well, now that would work.
That would work. I'm on that.
There you go.
Okay, so go ahead. What's trivia?
Kansas City Chiefs draft history. Since the AFL-NFL merger, named the only quarterback the Chiefs have ever drafted in the first round.
The only quarterback that the Chiefs have drafted in the first round.
Correct.
Well, I would say Len Dawson, but
that's probably too obvious.
I was going to say that's probably too obvious and maybe too early.
Lenny was actually drafted by the Steelers back in the day.
Oh, by Terry Bradshaw.
Yeah.
Hi, Len.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah, well, the answer is Todd Blackledge from the Vontic 1983 class.
Right.
Elliott was already off the board.
Right.
But they passed on Esiason, Kelly, Marino, and we ended up with Todd Blackledge. And ever since then, the Chiefs have had such cold feet about drafting the quarterback in the first round.
Right.
And the fan base really wants a quarterback. We return almost all the starters. And from last year, from a 12-4 team last year, so a pretty solid team.
Right.
And they've got to draft. A lot of people feel like they need to draft a quarterback for the future.
Sure.
But there's a lot of doubts whether that will ever happen with this organization.
Well, one of the guys I see here has Deshaun Watson falling to you guys at 27.
If that would happen, I would be backflip. Because all the projections I've seen have him in the mid to upper teens. My problem is once you get past Watson, then you're looking at maybe Patrick Mahomes out of Texas Tech. And I don't know if he's worthy of being drafted that high, but I know that they've got a situation from a contract standpoint that Alex Smith is definitely going to be the quarterback next year. No ifs, ands, or buts.
Yeah.
And this would be a perfect opportunity for a rookie to come in, learn under Alex, you know, carry the clipboard, be the backup, you know, gain on his valuable experience. And then, you know, maybe a year from now, we'll be looking at somebody that the Chiefs actually developed and turned into a decent starting quarterback.
Yeah, and I agree with you. I think they do need to make that move eventually. Of course, you have the hole with Lamar Charles, you know, being shipped out of there. Two of them have you taking running backs, one being Christian McCaffrey and the other one being Dalvin Cook, who I think those could be nice players for you if that happened that way, too.
Well, the scuttlebutt here is McCaffrey. Most people think Cook will be gone by then. We believe it's the 27th pick of the first round. But McCaffrey would be somebody who would really fit in good. He's very versatile. You can play him on special teams. He can play the flat, he can play receiver, he can play running back. He's a very durable, versatile guy. He's the smallest guy, but I could see him being a threat here.
Sure. Yeah, I think he would. I think you could do a lot worse than him. Well, Scott, we're getting up against the end of the show here, but I thank you for taking your valuable time to come on here.
No problem.
Absolutely.
And of course, we'll be getting together again on April 23rd to have the mock draft where you'll pick as the general manager for the Kansas City Chiefs. And then we'll see how close we are to being right.
Yeah, just bring my barbecue when you come, please.
I don't remember you guys answering the question.
Well, Scott, thank you again, and we look forward to talking to you here in a couple weeks.
All right, so take care. Have a good evening.
You too. And that was Scott Wilcox from Kansas City.
Man, we've had a pretty good show tonight.
Yeah,
we've got a lot of our GMs are getting geared up here.
Absolutely.
Football season starts again, guys.
It's football season every day, isn't it, Bill?
I don't think it ever ends. I mean,
when spring gets here, that's what we start thinking about, football, right?
We do. Well, baseball will start for about a week or two, and then the NFL draft will come.
Monday's opening day for the Reds, right?
It is. Yeah. It is. And
it's all downhill from there.
Yeah. Well, I mean, Lee, they do well the first couple of weeks. But it's over certainly by the 4th of July.
Yeah.
Well, see, Chisenhall's already out for the Indians, so, they're going to start down a little bit. But we will see how baseball starts. Of course, we'll talk about that a little bit next week. And, Rick, I'm pursuing the commissioner, the Ohio Athletic Commission.
Pursuing him?
I'm pursuing him to get him on our show.
Oh, okay.
Who is it now? You caught me off guard.
Okay.
I don't have it right here. I don't want to mispronounce his name.
Tim Stride is who I always talk to, but he's actually in charge of media, so not the same person.
This guy's the director,
right?
And we're going to talk to him, if we get him on, about professional wrestling.
Yeah, which now
professional
it's
wrestling
regulated.
It's been deregulated.
What does that mean?
You don't have to have insurance, and you do not have to be licensed.
Wow.
That's pro wrestling, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which is one of the things that we hope that maybe we'll start bringing on some of the myriad of niche sports that we're going to do.
I'll be Bill's manager.
Yes. Yeah. Well, that's right. Well, and Bill knows all the moves.
We'll do the steel cage matches.
There you go.
Yeah.
And I'll stay outside.
They also sanctioned the Ohio version of the MMA.
Yep.
And then...
Really?
Yep. So they have their own Ohio championships in that. Mm-hmm. And so we will get them on. Oh, boxing. They regulate boxing in the state, too.
They do.
And so it'll be interesting to try to get them on and let you know about, again, as Rick said, some of the niche sports that you might not know about in the state of Ohio. And we're going to talk about where these events are taking place. So if you have an interest in going out and seeing a professional wrestling match or an MMA match, not have to spend an arm and a leg to do it, you'll be able to do it here locally.
And we got a lot of exciting developments that are going on. This week is going to be a big week for both WALH as well as WZAA and Campus Nation because we're moving an antenna and a transmitter. So, Lee, you speak to that. We're going to be off the air from about noon on Saturday?
Sunday afternoon, early evening, we'll have WALH. The antenna moved. It's going to be so high that satellites will have to be reprogrammed to go around.
Well, that's right. Yeah, so that'll all occur over the weekend.
The
stream will still be operating. It'll just be over the air.
Nothing will change there.
Right, and then that'll all be done, and we'll be in good shape as far as WALH. And then WZAA, currently in actually downtown Jeffersonville, we will be finishing up our lease, signing it this next week, and starting to move into the new studios, which will house the the radio station at 106.9, as sure. well as Campus Nation and Talk TV, all the things that we're doing on our network will be there.
District.
Yeah, so it's going to be a great location
right.
for us, and
right.
all that will be taking place next week.
Yeah.
And then we'll be able to apply to have that move made for the yep. For the radio station. So all yep. those people that you're listening to us right now up there in Fayette County and southeastern Greene County, we will be getting bigger and better here just mm-hmm. with that move. So
yeah, we hope to be adding programming for yeah. Miami Trace
right.
and
Washington, the
Washington
Blue
High
Lions.
School.
Right.
And so that'll be coming in the near future here as we start coordinating with those two schools with
yep.
our programming
all
efforts.
All coming.
Right. Yep.
So I guess we've finished our 2 hours of broadcast excellence here.
Yep.
And
for
Lee Hindy, for our host Bill Raybeck, this is Rick Phillips. We want to thank everybody for listening. And across the network, good night, everybody.
Good night, everyone. All right.